sermon text this morning is the whole chapter of Ezekiel 33. I will begin the reading now at verse 10. And you, son of man, say to the house of Israel, thus have you said, surely our transgressions and our sins are upon us, and we rot away because of them. How then can we live? Say to them, as I live, declares the Lord, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn back from your evil ways, for why will you die, O house of Israel? And you, son of man, say to your people, the righteousness of the righteous shall not deliver him when he transgresses. And as for the wickedness of the wicked, he shall not fall by it when he turns from his wickedness. And the righteous shall not be able to live by his righteousness when he sins. Though I say to the righteous that he shall surely live, yet if he trusts in his righteousness and does injustice, none of his righteous deeds shall be remembered. And in his injustice that he has done, he shall die. Again, though I say to the wicked, you shall surely die, yet if he turns from his sins and does what is just and right, if the wicked restores the pledge, gives back what he has taken by robbery, and walks in the statutes of life, not doing injustice, he shall surely live, he shall not die. None of the sins that he has committed shall be remembered against him. He has done what is just and right, he shall surely live. Yet your people say, the way of the Lord is not just, when it is their own way that is not just. When a righteous turns from his righteousness and does injustice, he shall die for it. When the wicked turns from his wickedness and does what is just and right, he shall live by this. Yet you say, the way of the Lord is not just. O house of Israel, I will judge each of you according to his ways. In the 12th year of our exile, in the 10th month, on the 5th day of the month, a fugitive from Jerusalem came to me and said, the city has been struck down. Now the hand of the Lord had been upon me the evening before the fugitive came, and he opened my mouth by the time the man came to me in the morning. So my mouth was open, and I was no longer mute. This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Holy Father, we do ask you that as we come to your scriptures, we ask that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts would be found pleasing and acceptable in your sight. And we ask this in the name of Jesus, who is our Lord, our rock, our redeemer, and kinsman. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated. What is your default response when you experience trials and hardships in your life? In Psalm 63, David describes these sorts of seasons as being in a dry desert land where all of the streams of water have been dried up. Are you tempted to despair, to curse God, to blame him for the situation you are in, to blame your circumstances, to push the blame on all of your past mistakes? Or do you seek God's face, your soul thirsting for God, your flesh fainting for his presence? Do you complain and turn from God, or does your soul cling to God? In this passage, we finally arrive at the collapse of Jerusalem. All the worst dreams of the exiles have come true. Their home is gone, the promised land is destroyed, the temple has been reduced to rubble. Ezekiel has spent the better part of a decade at this point and 34 chapters of our Bible warning the people, acting out the siege and the fall of Jerusalem, and finally, the day that he has prophesied has arrived. And so the question is, how now that judgment has come, will the people respond? How will God now respond to his people now that judgment has come? And these two questions, how the people will now respond and how God will now respond to his people, are really the questions that occupy the rest of Ezekiel's book. Will the people finally now change, and will God offer restoration for a broken people? And this passage hinges on the fall of Jerusalem. We don't see the fall until verses 21 through 22. And so there are two sections leading up to the fall of Jerusalem. And Ezekiel is dealing with people who realize that the end is imminent, that the destruction of Jerusalem is right around the corner, and they are tempted to despair. And what we didn't read this morning, but we will cover in verses 23 and the rest, we see Ezekiel responding to the immediate aftermath of the destruction of Jerusalem and the people's immediate response to it. And one interesting thing that you might have noticed in what we have read so far in our passage is that this passage contains lots of themes that we have already seen in the book of Ezekiel. For instance, the first 11 chapters deal with Ezekiel as the watchman. Verse 7, "So you, son of man, I have made a watchman for the house of Israel." Now this is an idea, this is a picture, this is an image that we have seen all the way back in chapter 3. When God had called Ezekiel when he was by the waters of the Chebar Canal, and God came to him in his chariot and called him to be his prophet, one of the things that he told him is that you are to be a watchman, that you are to be a sentry, that you are to be someone who is positioned to keep watch over the camp or over the city at night, and you are to have your eyes peered outward for the enemy, and you are to stay awake, you are to keep watch, and you are to yell out warning to the people when the enemy approaches. Here in chapter 33, God presents a similar situation. That God is the one who is bringing a sword upon the land, and when the watchman sees the sword coming, he must warn the people. He says, if anyone hears the shouts of the warning, but they don't take cover, they don't rush to the walls to defend the city, if the people hear the warning but just go about their business, if they don't make any changes to their life, then he says, their guilt is on their own head. The people are responsible for heeding the watchman's warning, for changing their behavior in the face of the enemy. But what if the watchman sees the enemy coming and he refuses to shout any warnings, he refuses to blow his trumpet? God says, then the watchman is the one responsible, and God will hold him guilty. God then tells Ezekiel that he has been called as this watchman, and he has been charged to shout warning to the people that God is coming in judgment. I feel if you remember all the way back to chapter 3 and a couple months ago, all of this is very familiar. It's all the same content that we see in chapter 3. And so the question is, why do we find it again here? Well, if we read chapter 3 closely, the thing you will notice is that this message about a watchman is a private message from God to Ezekiel. It's part of Ezekiel's calling, and so Ezekiel is the only one with an ear to hear this message of being called to be a watchman. This watchman is part of Ezekiel's prophetic call to ministry. It is part of his description of what he is to do as a prophet. So being a watchman is part of his identity. It is part of his own self-understanding. It is a personal warning that God gives him about the necessity to be faithful in his call as a watchman. He is to be deadly serious about performing the call that God has given him. And so after 32 chapters, after 8 years of Ezekiel's life, we are at this point left with no question that Ezekiel has been faithful to this call. But here in chapter 33, the message of Ezekiel as a watchman, it's not a private message for Ezekiel, but God says, go and tell the people that you are the watchman. And so this idea, this image of a watchman hits us from a different perspective. In chapter 3, the perspective, the emphasis was on that Ezekiel, as God's watchman, was responsible to deliver the warning faithfully. But here the emphasis in chapter 33 is that the people are also responsible to hear and respond to those warnings. The watchman image comes at this point in Ezekiel to press upon the people that for 8 years, for 33 chapters, they have failed time and again to hear and listen to the warning that Ezekiel had been giving them. Ezekiel has acted as the faithful watchman prophet, when he has denounced the people as being wicked, he is giving them Yahweh's own verdict. When he delivers death as a sentence, when he has given a sentence of fire and sword and famine that is coming, that is Yahweh's own sentence upon the people. And so he has spent about a decade trying to pull off the self-deceptive spectacles off of the eyes of the people. They have been living, believing that no matter what they did, no matter how they acted, no matter how greatly they sinned, no matter how they rebelled against God, well, they were still his covenant people. They still belonged to him, and so they self-assuredly believed nothing bad could ever happen to them. And Ezekiel had been trying to wake themselves up to the reality about themselves and trying to wake themselves up to the reality about God. And they have refused to hear God's word about themselves. And so the question we can ask ourselves at this point is, what is it that ultimately colors our perspective about ourselves and our world? Do we heed God's word given in his scriptures and use that to color our reality, our understanding about ourselves and our world? Or do we instead rely on our own feelings, our prideful assumptions about ourselves, or what the world tells us is truth? For this is how the Jews of Ezekiel's day thought. Instead of responding to God's word given in the prophet and receiving it as truth, they found all sorts of logical, they found all sorts of emotional reason to reject that word. Well, God could not be against us if we still have the temple in which his presence dwells. Well, we simply don't feel like we are guilty. The bad ones are the ones who have already been taken away to exile, and those of us who remain in Jerusalem are the good ones. And so again and again, they have rejected God's word, and that rejection has now brought them on the brink of destruction. And so at this point, no one can deny what is going to happen. We can see at this point that food is running out, that the walls of Jerusalem are beginning to wobble. They have failed to turn, and Jerusalem's fall is now inevitable. They are sitting on the edge of destruction, and this has caused some of the exiles to despair. They are saying to one another, verse 10, "Surely our transgressions and our sins are upon us, and we rot away because of them. How then can we live?" Now, this is a statement that is on the lips of the exile. This seems to be a saying that they are telling one another, "Hey, we are sinners, and our sins and our transgressions are now making us rot away here in exile. How are we going to keep on living?" If you remember, what we have seen is that all of their hopes, all the dreams, all the expectation of the exile is simply set on returning to Jerusalem, returning to their old home, returning to their old way of life. And Ezekiel has again and again, through different ways, tried to tell them that the past is gone, that they are not to look to the past, that they are never going to return to the past. And he calls them to look forward to the new thing that God is going to do. But now that their past, their home, the object of their hope is as good as gone, and they continue to, instead of looking ahead in hope, saying, well, the past is now completely gone, the only place we can look is now the future, what God is going to do. Instead of turning toward the future, instead of turning to the Lord, they simply despair. And we should see at this point that something has changed, that at some level they have come to a realization of their sin. This is the very first time in all of Ezekiel that there is some sort of confession of sin upon the lips of the people. Our sins are haunting us. Because of our sins, we are rotting away here in exile. But for a lot of reasons, we'll see through the chapter, this seems to fall short of a true repentance. They are sorrowful, but sorrowful over their pain. They are sorrowful over their punishment for their sins. And they do not turn to the Lord. They do not put their faith that he is their God, even in exile, even apart from Jerusalem, even apart from the temple. They do not believe that God can simply get in his chariot and bring his glorious presence to be with them in Babylon. They think that they have been utterly forsaken by God, that there is no future, and so they despair, asking themselves, how can we go on living? But God sees this as a teachable moment. He asked them, in effect, you want to talk about life? Then let's talk about life. But if we want to talk about life, what we need to begin with is talking about God's character. And God explains his character in this way in verse 11. As I live, God says, and we should see that this is an affirmation of promise. When we see God saying, as I live, we should think that this is God placing his hand upon himself, swearing an oath upon his own character. As I live, declares the Lord, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but rather that he turn from his ways and live. Turn back from your evil ways, for why will you die, O house of Israel? And so the people, having seen the justice of God displayed in this deadly judgment, have arrived at the conclusion that God simply enjoys punishing his people, that God smiles at their death. And since he enjoys dishing out punishment, there is nothing they can do other than settle down and wait for their own death. We have seen something of this logic before in Ezekiel, where the people declared, well, God has abandoned us, so there's nothing to do anyway. It doesn't matter what we do. And so the implication is there's no need to make any changes in our lives. Right? If God simply enjoys punishment, there's no reason to change. If God has abandoned us already, there's no reason to change. Let's just keep on giving ourselves over to sin. But as Jesus says, God is the God of the living. That God is the author of life. That God is the one who gave Adam his own life, breathing into his nostrils the breath of life. That God offered Adam the possibility of eternal life in fellowship with him. He also promised Adam death as a consequence of breaking fellowship with him. And then after Adam plunged us into a world of sin and death, we should understand that the rest of human history is a history of God delivering his people out of that death. And it should never cease to amaze us that God was willing to undergo death in order to deliver us from death. That God himself was willing to die in order to deliver us from death. God hates death so much that he would give his only son that we would not perish but have eternal life. We should understand that this is the very character of God. After Ezekiel points to the character of God, he then sets before them an illustration and example for them to consider. And once again, we have seen a longer illustration in chapters 18 with the same point. Ezekiel says, well, consider a righteous man, a man who lives uprightly, a man who has walked with God for a long time, who has walked according to God's word, and this man puts all of his trust in his past righteousness and saying, well, I've been pretty good for a long time, and so I am going to turn my ways, I am going to give myself over to sin, but I'm still okay because I had a long history of righteousness. God says that man will die. But then Ezekiel tells us to consider a wicked man, an evil man, a man under the sentence of death. But having heard that warning, having heard that sentence of death, he turns from his sin. He turns toward justice and righteousness. He repents of his ways. God says that man shall live and not die. And it's the second case at this point that Ezekiel is especially interested in. Because this is the very situation that the people are facing in verse 10. They find themselves filled with sin, riddled with sin, under the sentence of death. What can we do? And Ezekiel's answer is turn from that sin and from that wickedness. Turn from that despair. Turn toward God. Walk in his ways. And he promises that you will find life. life. And of course, these people are like a teenager who has it all figured out. And so they have another response in verse 17. They say, well, we can't repent. We won't repent because God's ways are not just. So at this point, we really think that maybe they're not actually understanding the weight of their sin because they're saying, well, God's ways are arbitrary. God's ways are nonsensical. God's ways do not make sense. God's ways are not just. God is going to do what God is going to do. And so again, there's no need for us to change. And they truly do not believe at this point that what they are experiencing is the consequences of their sin, but rather what they are experiencing is God's arbitrary anger. And Ezekiel answers and explains that what God is doing is only responding to them. That the destruction, the chaos, the fall of Jerusalem, all of the judgment they have experienced is simply God responding to their own injustice and their own evil. Once again, Ezekiel presses upon them, if you turn from God and his ways, you will die, but if you turn from your wickedness, you will live. And so after this debate that Ezekiel has with the people, we get the news that we have all been waiting for. On the 12th year of exile, on the 10th month, on the 5th day, the promised messenger from Jerusalem has arrived with the terrible yet unexpected news that Jerusalem has fallen. And we should note that there is no recorded response. Remember that Ezekiel in chapter 24, when his wife dies, he was not allowed to mourn. And God said that this is a sign that the people in exile, when they hear about the fall of Jerusalem, they will not respond. They will not mourn. And so here in Ezekiel, when the people hear the news that Jerusalem has fallen, there is no response recorded. We find only silence, except for Ezekiel. For if you remember back again at the call of chapter 3, when Ezekiel was called to the prophet, one of the things we are told is that God says, I will cause the tongue to stick to the top of your mouth. I will cause you to become mute. I will cause you to be unable to preach in the normal sense. So the only time Ezekiel could speak to the people was when God specifically used him to speak the actual words of God, where God used Ezekiel sort of as his hand puppet to give his particular message. But now, for the first time since that moment in chapter 3, Ezekiel's mouth was open. He was able to speak to the people, and he was able to give new words, words of hope, words of encouragement, words of restoration to the people. And so here, it opens up the possibility of a new start, a new beginning for Israel. But immediately, beginning in chapter 23, we see that God's judgments have ultimately, at this point, left the hearts of the people unchanged. God comes to Ezekiel and gives him the message about what is going on back in the land of Judah, back among the broken down remnant of the land of Judah. And if you look at verse 26, what we see seems to be a kind of anarchic, post-apocalyptic, Mad Max type of situation. Society has broken down. People are relying only on the sword to get their way. They commit sins, they rape, they kill, they seek power, they continue to serve their idols. And yet, despite of this situation, the people were also filled with self-assurance. They argued with one another that, well, Abraham was just one person, and God gave him this whole land. Look how many we are. Look how powerful we are. Surely this land is now ours to possess. So it seems like what is happening is that the faith of Abraham, the covenant that God made with Abraham, is now replaced by a sort of ancient Darwinism. That the strongest have survived the onslaught, and so therefore the strongest, and look how many there are of us, look how strong we are. We are the survivors. Surely this land is now ours. There is no mention of God. There is no mention of the covenant. There is no mention of God's promise to Abraham. only their numbers and their strength. And so God says to them in verse 27 and 29 that their end is also coming. God will continue to bring the sword. He will bring beasts. He will bring famine. And these proud and haughty men will come to ruin. And they will know that Yahweh is God. Beginning in verse 30, the situation among the exiles is not better. What is interesting is that the news of the fall of Jerusalem seems to have kind of helped Ezekiel in a very personal way. It seems that when the news of Jerusalem came, he attained some sort of a celebrity preacher situation. The exile would talk about him as they would cross one another in leaving their houses. Ezekiel had become the talk of the town. And so they would say, let's go listen to this strange and interesting prophet, but they do not hear his message. They listen for entertainment value. It says that he is the singer of lustful love songs, that he is an ancient Frank Sinatra, good for an evening out of town to go hear the strange prophet speak his strange message. And this returns us once again to the first 11 verses, that they continue to fail to heed the words of the watchman. They heard his warning. They heard his call to repentance. They may shout amen, but only because they are being entertained, not because they are being cut to the heart. And this is a warning to us about how we listen to preaching and preachers. Do we listen for entertainment? Do we listen to be simply taught our mind? Do we listen to learn some facts? Or do we listen to hear the word of the Lord that comes from faithful preaching? Now I want to take a moment here and consider more deeply verse 12, which offers us a summary of so much of what Ezekiel has for us to know. Again, it is simply summarizing his argument in that middle section. The righteousness of the righteous will not deliver him when he sins. And as for the wickedness of the wicked, he shall not fall from it when he turns from his wickedness. This is one of the central truths of Scripture that is so easy for us to forget, that Christ has come not to call the righteous, but he has come to call sinners to repent. And so we may be tempted to despair because of our own situation. We might look at our past lives, our past sin, and it makes us feel like we are completely unredeemable and unforgivable people. Or perhaps we look at our past and we see all the ways that we have been sinned against. We see patterns of abuse and patterns of sin that have been set by our parents, and it makes us feel like we are trapped in a cycle that again makes us unredeemable. But the gospel is that Christ has come to redeem the unredeemable and to forgive the unforgivable. All of the ugliness of your past does not and will not matter if you simply turn from it and turn to Christ. But like the Israelites, instead of responding to this gospel message in hope, oftentimes we push blame back on God. We may talk about covenant curses, or we might have a fatalistic understanding of God's sovereignty. Nothing can change because I am under judgment. Nothing can change because God's the one who is in control, and he's out to get me. And yes, God is in control, but God is also the one who says he has a great desire for you to have life, that his desire is for you to have life and not death. And so Ezekiel holds out to the Jews and holds out to us the possibility of turning from our past, turning from our sin, turning from our wickedness towards righteousness, away from death and towards life, away from death and towards Christ. Your past does not determine your future. What determines your future is the response of the gospel today, your response to the gospel now, and your response to the gospel every moment is what will determine your future. When we hear the gospel of repentance, it should give us hope. The gospel is simple. Jesus Christ has come to save sinners from their sin. The gospel offers life to all those who turn from their sin and face Jesus Christ and walk in Him. The gospel is simple, but it takes a humble heart to receive it. And so, instead of responding to that simple and profound good news in the gospel, we can often stumble over theology. We can often stumble over our path. And so we push excuses and we push blame. But Christ says He has come to offer you life and life abundantly. The way that we receive this life is to turn from our sins and walk with your eyes fixed in hope, your eyes fixed in faith, and your eyes fixed with love upon Christ. And so this is the offer before you, the way of life or the way of death. And you are urged this morning in the Lord to choose the life of Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we do ask and beg that we would be people who choose life in Christ. That we would be those who look not upon our past, either looking toward our own righteousness and thinking that we don't need to change, or that we look at our past and think that we are unredeemable and unforgivable. Lord, help us to take our eyes off of ourselves and to put them upon Christ, to walk faithfully in Him, to walk hopefully in Him, and to walk in His love. In His name we pray. Amen.
Amen.